Hello everyone, and welcome to this afternoon's event. My name is Julian Cox. I'm the Deputy Director and Chief Curator at the AGO, and it's wonderful to have you with us. Important to say first and foremost that I'm speaking to you from land that is the territory of the Anishinaabe Mississauga Nation, and was also the land of the Haudenosaunee, the Huron-Wendat, the Neutral and Seneca Nations through time. And it's with great respect and gratitude that we conduct our work in this place. It's really fabulous to have this afternoon along with us Wanda Nanabush, the curator of Indigenous art here at the AGO, who works in collaboration in union with Georgiana Ulyarik, our curator of Canadian art, and the artist Nicholas Galamin. Tonight's program is generously sponsored by Tiffany & Company, and we thank them for their continued support of the Curator's Circle here at the AGO. Tonight's guest, Nicholas Galamin, was born in 1979 in Sitka, Alaska, and where he lives and works. It's about 90 miles southwest from Juneau, the state capital, and you kind of have to get from A to B by boat. He has a really interesting background. He earned his BFA at the London Guildhall University in 2003 and his MFA at the Massey University in Palmerston North in New Zealand. That was in 2007. And as part of his broad artistic training, he's apprenticed with master carvers and jewelers. His work was included in the Native American Pavilion at the 2017 Venice Biennale. And in 2019, his work appeared at both the Whitney Biennial and the Honolulu Biennial. His works of art are also in permanent collections across North America in really important major museums, such as the Museum of Modern Art in New York, Art Institute of Chicago, Museum of Fine Arts Houston, the LA County Museum, National Gallery of Canada, Vancouver Art Gallery, and of course, by no means least, the Art Gallery of Ontario. We've got some of that, Nicholas's work in our collection as well. And we're really thrilled to have him this afternoon for this conversation. He's going to talk about how his work engages contemporary culture from his perspective, of course, rooted in connection to the land, and how it explores dialogues of exchange between Indigenous and non-Indigenous histories and cultures. And his work, as you'll see, is by turns political, generous, unflinching, poetic, and many more adjectives beside. And so we're really grateful to have you with us, Nicholas. And without any further ado, I'll turn things over to you and Wanda to take it away. Thanks.
Thank you, Julian. Welcome everybody out there that we can't see. Thank you for being here, the AGO Curatorial Circle community. And thanks, Nick, for coming on here and having this chat with us tonight. I'm Wanda Nanabush, Anishinaabe Kwe from Beausoleil First Nation, Wolf Clan, and Nick and I have known each other for a lot of years. And I was trying to remember the very first time, and it was really difficult. I was like, because we've seen each other in many countries as well over the last 15 years. But I think it was Denver, wasn't it?
That's what I was going to say. Yeah, Denver, like 2007 or something, maybe.
Yes, we were doing all the crazy gallivanting across the town, interacting. Lots of monuments that they have there, which will be part of the conversation today. And we also did some crazy performances on stage, all kinds of stuff we did.
Yeah.
And then I remembered doing that first exhibition with you, your solo exhibition in Toronto, and that was in 2010.
Yes.
So that was a really exciting time. I did want to say a little bit about how I do feel you are one of the most independent, free thinkers and creators in our community. And your work has really guided me and filled me with hope, actually.
Oh, thank you. Oh, and wow.
Exciting contemporary workers today.
That's, yeah, really amazing.
Just to make you uncomfortable.
Yeah, you're embarrassing me.
Would you like to introduce yourself in your own way?
Sure, yes. Yehietsin Yuhat Duasak, Hluknahadi Hatsati, Kagwantanyadi Ayahat, Shika Kwan. My name is Yehietsin Nicholas Galanin. I am Hluknahadi, child of the Kagwantan, people of Sitka. And I am based in my home, Sitka, Alaska. So this is where I'm speaking to you from today. I'm just grateful to be here. Always, you know, you're mentioning these times and where does the time go? I feel like we're reminiscing about 2007 with Dr. James Luna and Rebecca Belmore, and you know, just I feel always forever grateful to be part of this community in ways of sharing and an exchange and conversation. And I feel like I've got such great mentors that have come before to really just learn and look up to. So yeah,
I feel the same. And the last time we saw each other was at Abuquad at the Sydney Biennial, Nirin.
Yes.
Biennial curated by an Indigenous man, our lovely Brooke Andrew. And we got a chance to hear from you about your new work there, which we will hear about today as well. But I was just thinking, like, we started this, the last time I saw you was when the pandemic was called, and we're all flying back home after being intensely with each other over, you know, thousands of us intensely together for like a couple of weeks. And now here we are on Zoom.
Yes. Just 2 weeks, they said.
Yeah. And what we're gathered here tonight to start talking about, and what sort of prompted this conversation, was our recent acquisition of A Space Between Life and Death, a work you created in 2015. From two taxidermied wolves. And I thought we could start out speaking about this work. I know that it was partly created for an exhibition that was dealing with life and death, but I thought we could start with the wolves themselves. And how they...
Sure. This work has definitely been, through its variations, I suppose, from Inert and We Dreamt Death, two other found taxidermy pieces. And they all come from a you know, similar concepts and intentions, I think, in their own ways. You know, they're unique too. But the A Space Between Life and Death followed Inert. Inert was a work that, and I know we didn't include in this, I don't think we have a photo of We Dreamt Death, which is a polar bear piece.
No, I didn't put it in here. Sorry about that.
The larger polar bear work was actually the very first concept that I'd arrived at in, you know, these pieces. But I couldn't realize the work because it was so difficult to source taxidermy polar bears, and still, even as we understand the legalities of shipping internationally, wolves or any of these objects, which is also, I think, an important aspect of this work, really, is how these borders have crossed and continue to impact our communities and our exchanges. And I'm going to that in a little bit here, but so that We Dreamt Death work sat in a sketchbook for like 10 years, probably, until I was able to finally, you know, A, afford, and B, like, source a polar bear that was right for the project. But until then, Inert and the other work were created. And for me, and these pieces, the wolf, especially the front wolf in A Space Between Life and Death, represents what I would say is our communities and our Indigenous culture as we navigate colonial restrictions, colonial rules, colonial borders and boundaries, narratives, colonial historical narratives, and homogenized knowledge that's Indigenous but not valued till it's been homogenized through academia or colonial methodology. And for me, this visual aspect of the sculpture, the back half of that represents that container of, you know, literally every aspect of our being at some point, even our ceremonial objects being contained in institutional spaces, our knowledge, our elders' knowledge being contained through text that's not valued until it goes through that homogenization. Our identities and our ways of relating to our communities, our land being contained by borders. So all of these things, and of course, our resilience of our community is the wolf that's moving, the wolf that's free, that can bite when it needs to. And so this work relates to that in a way, I suppose. And it's relationship to that also is, you know, one that we could even look at trophy and how trophy and that idea of trophy is so foreign to our Indigenous communities versus the, you know, the colonial mentality of taxidermy and taking these objects and placing them in these spaces and stuffing them and creating this form of that. So there's two real distinct, clear differences and relationship to place in this conversation when you look at those two ideas of belonging, those ideas of how we exist in the present moment is also part of this particular piece here. So for me, a space between life and death is now, and it's that's a way of understanding that being present, I suppose, that's such an important aspect too when you look at what narratives frame our existence, and that generally is historical narratives, our romanticized stereotype narratives that place us frozen in a space or a time in the past. And this title to me says otherwise. And the work that we do says otherwise continually, every day that we show up and challenge these things, and not only challenge them, but demonstrate them through what I would call creative sovereignty or creative power of this freedom of realizing work and ideas as we need to, and as we get to decide, I suppose. So, I don't know where else to go with that. Here is kind of a lot of things at once.
We're going to see them all again as we go through. The way in which the wolf that is a rug, you know, it's like the felt underneath really makes it kind of hone into the product nature, which when you're talking about, you know, a dead culture or something you might see, I also think museums in some ways can be spaces that give life to creative things, or they can kill them, you know? Mm-hmm. And so the way we operate in the museum, I always think this is a picture of the struggle that we have inside institutions too.
Yeah.
And as Wolf Clan, it's like, they're my brothers, you know, my kin. And so it's kind of an amazing thing to be able to bring them into the museum as well. Like once we are able to put them on view, every time I'm going to walk by them, they're going to feel like my kin in some strange way. I also think taxidermy is really unnerving for people because it is between life and death, and it kind of raises up your own status as dying and living at once, right? Like you're talking about in the now.
Yeah. There is definitely aspects to this work that I don't know if I anticipated or not, but the engagement of somebody that might be more endearing towards an animal than a human at some point, and I find that is interesting, I suppose, to consider. So.
You're a hunter, are you not? A fisherman?
Yes, hunting and fishing. We live off the land. We live with the land.
Do you think that makes you relate to this work differently, or these works
differently? I feel like the work that I do through that type of life and living is actually different than some of these things, because these aren't wolves I've hunted. Mm-hmm. They're, you know, again, taxidermied, found taxidermied, and they come from different sources that I think are actually, you know, very different understanding than the way that I will connect to place and hunt and land and in doing so. So when we do this, we do it to, you know, for sustenance, to survive, to feed our families. It's, you know, there's cultural practice and protocol, and there's even as we talk about, like, we talked a little bit about the borders crossing in our communities and the complications that arise from that. Hunting seal and sea otter here in Southeast Alaska is a major political aspect of existing, really, for if I do that culturally. And it is because it's federally regulated on who gets to hunt seal or sea otter. And that regulation is based on colonial rules of blood quantum. So this idea of authenticity based upon measurement of your connection to your family lineage based on whether or not you were registered or your family was on a certain era and period of time frame. And there are, there's a cutoff point. I think it's like a 16th, after a 16th of blood quantum, you're not allowed to touch a sea otter or to process it or to handle it or a seal. And I have friends here who practice and hunt culturally and, you know, do that work, and their children can't. Their children can't go with them. They can't learn it. They can't handle it. And so some of those conversations, I think, are engaged in this work, even without, even though it's not completely direct. And I think we find that out through shipment of, or the process of shipment. The irony with sea otter and seal is that because of the federal regulations, it's, and these ideas of who can and who can't hunt it or deal with it or process it, it's just so poorly, like, thought out and planned, and it is just, it's reductive to, it's detractive to our communities completely. Like everything, like our whole existence battles with this detractiveness that only subtracts things from us. And it's important to, you know, maybe engage works that can envision versions that are not detractive. And that's a good segue into this piece, I think, which is literally, so the titles, Never Forget, this was just installed at Desert X, Agua Caliente, Quahila community and land is where this is up right now. And the actual piece, well, let's just talk about some of the layers here real quick. So this, the Indian land text based off of the iconic Hollywood sign, which many people are probably familiar with, comments on the origination of the Hollywood land sign, which was a real estate advertisement for white only real estate developments. And it went on to become this iconic sign and image of an industry that is largely responsible for people for representations or misrepresentations of, you know, very American movie industry, pop culture, all of these things. And in that, within that institution, Like many institutions, Indigenous communities were largely misrepresented, stereotyped historically throughout those narratives. And those narratives are ones that became upheld and in based on media and based on those popular cultures. The work itself is to scale, so they're 45-foot letters. The reference in the language is, of course, nomenclature. Is that the word the I'm looking for?
Nomenclature.
Thank you. Of an era of that's still, you know, used by the United States government to blanket over 500 Indigenous communities, unique and their own histories, languages, cultures, and is a term that's been utilized to monolithically represent these communities, I suppose, legally and legal writings of removal of from our communities and our lands, and one aspect of it. One thing that I think this goes back to too is those land grabs and those advertisements for Indian land for sale, Indian land grabs, free land. Manifest destiny in this move and this push to displace our cultures and our communities at the literal genocide to make way for what is, you know, the American dream of sorts, I suppose.
Moving from like thinking about land as this kind of
privatizing it into chopped up private sales and you know, especially the history of land in all, every community's experience is going to be largely different. To learn about the history in this community is very interesting, of the way that it had been checkered boarded and allocated for settler versus and then Indigenous community, and that's, you know, that's one space and location. This work's not meant to just speak to that space. It's meant to speak to a larger conversation, and in multiple communities. There's landless Indigenous communities in Alaska. We had the Alaska Native Land Claims Act that our communities had fought for some representation or access to land, and it surfaced through that ANCSA, which meant that the land that was allocated back to our communities could only be managed through Indigenous corporations, which is, mm-hmm. you know, has its problems in its own, because now we're tossed into capitalism and resource. And when I'm out here hunting and fishing and with my family, that doesn't make sense to me, that I have a few shares in this corporation that manages the land here or mismanages it, depends on which corporation and community we're talking about, where I get $300 check once a year or something. Like meanwhile, we have people in our communities that can't afford rent. So on the surface, this piece looks grand and monumental, but the reality is this is not actually the work. The work is the call to action. Understand that land acknowledgement has become more and more common in institution. And with that, you start to recognize that it becomes generally lip service if there's no action that follows it. And the call to action here is for landowners to participate in returning land back to their Indigenous communities. There's not been anybody that's stepped into this call to action yet, but that's part of the work too. It's telling in its own right, like who's willing to participate It does happen. We do have examples of land back that has like the Native Arts and Culture Foundation in Portland recently received some land for their organization. So that's an example of it. It's also another side aspect of it is if you don't have that opportunity to participate directly by transferring land back to the community, you can still help fund acquisition of land. So paired up with Native American Land Conservancy, and they are located in Indigo, which is near this location. And the goal is to at least raise funds for land transfer of title back to them. So they they are trying to acquire sacred sites, cultural sites, and put them back into Indigenous care. This work also, I like to acknowledge that Indigenous care in relationship to place goes it goes so far back in our communities that it's definitely a form of care that benefits anybody that's there now, because we're not wrecking things as we see capitalism and colonial settler resource extractions, all these other things that are destroying our communities and our ecosystems. So
totally, I think the land back movement is a really important.
It is. It is, and there's lots of ways to engage it, and there's not. The revolution will not be GoFundMe'd, but but that's not the point. Like the point is that there's ways, and not all of these ways are perfect, but they can still be done and engaged.
So another way in which the sort of justification for land theft and removal of our communities, besides Hollywood and representations, is also the kind of representation of the powerful and the colonial figures like, you know, Captain Cook. And I wondered if you could talk about this piece, Shadow on the Land, also very recent, 2020, an excavation and a bush burial done for the Sydney Biennial. Monuments is such a huge discussion right now, and a lot of people are trying to understand what to do with the monuments to the colonial violence and the colonial figures who've enacted this violence. So I love what you did. So I think it's brilliant. Thank you.
Yeah, we're going to do a mass burial of colonial monuments.
Because it was the celebration of Captain Cook, right?
At the yeah, time. It was. So this work really unveiled at a time that couldn't have been planned, I think, with global conversations. I feel like we've been having these conversations in our communities for a long time. And even though we have these conversations, doesn't mean that other people care or listen or like, you know, can pick up traction in global or larger context. So with that in mind, yeah, I was in Sydney and Tiwi Islands even for maybe a year before the biennial. Brooke brought me out, and you know, I met with other communities and artisans, and in the Tiwi Islands, I actually visited the first site where the actual first exchange with I forget who the sailor was, but it wasn't Cook. Touched base on you know what is now Australia, I suppose, and I knew that this 250 year anniversary was coming up, and I, you know, we're familiar with these narratives in all of our communities. I think if as Indigenous people, when things like this are put into play and upheld in our community, we have lots of versions of that with the recent 150th. Transfer from Alaska to, or from Russia to the US. And of course, our people were always out, like not included in those conversations. So they do these gross reenactments still, even in these spaces of it. And it's really problematic. Anyways, during the, you know, the making of this piece, there the Black Lives Matters and anti-police brutality demonstrations and movements were really starting to pick up globally. And with that came other conversations surrounding our nation's monuments and statues. And in the US, we have, of course, really problematic racist statues, like many places, from Confederate to even some of the founding fathers of the government and you know, the atrocities that they participated in and building what is now America, US anyway. So there was the Roosevelt statue outside the Natural Museum of NMA, no, the the Archaeology Museum in New York. I forget what it's called. Anyways, and there, I was thinking about all of these things. And of course the Cook statue in Hyde Park has a discovery plinth on it. The irony of that language and that choice and that was taken into account in this process, I suppose. I wanted to bury it. I wanted to get, and the first proposal was to do an actual excavation archaeologically of the shadow on site. And we couldn't get permission. And I think it worked out for the better, to be honest, because some of the really lame arguments are like poor arguments of the of why we shouldn't remove statues is that, you know, it'll erase our history, et cetera, whatever. But I'd argue that this work engages more conversation in history without that statue even present than the statue itself does. But archaeology and digging down into the shape of the form of the statue, when you dig down, you're going to obviously reveal, especially in some of the oldest known civilizations on Earth, history of past generations. So utilizing that science, so the idea of that science, a science that has largely embraced white supremacy in its historical narratives towards our communities and cultures, to bury the monument. So the goal is to dig down deep enough that we can, you know, drop it in. It's a work in progress and process piece, so it's not necessarily going to hit that depth. And the other aspect is we couldn't hit that depth here particularly, and I think this is also a part of the work, is because of the pollution in the soil and talking about how polluted these spaces have become in areas due to colonization and resource extraction. Oftentimes those communities are indigenous communities that are, you know, faced to live within that space still. So we can only dig down so deep here because the soil was polluted.
It was interesting. You're like using archaeology against itself in a way.
Yeah. I think it's to be critical of those things is important. And
you started marking like indigenous presence though in your little flags and in little.
Yeah, flags. For sure. And it contradicts their, it uses that idea, that science or that idea to contradict itself in its narratives. And the contradiction would be when you dig down and you find existence of communities, yet you still hold this discovery plinth in front of it, is like, is clear as, how much clearer do we need to make things for the damaging erasure of language that's chosen to uphold these narratives, let alone celebrate them as this 250th anniversary of something, while all the while, like, not continuing to ignore and not acknowledge these communities still in these spaces. So
I think this work as well is sort of related, and this will be the last one we talk about before we open to questions from the, sure, the room, the virtual room, Architecture of Return and Escape done at the Met, and thinking about, you know, anthropology and ethnography and archaeology as the, and theft of our cultural belongings and the placement of them in museums like the Met.
Yeah, this is, this was piece based on this. It's almost a, you know, it's a blueprint. So one thing that some of these works have in common, I think, and I hope transmits is that they envision, they help envision, you know, futures where these things are not continued in our communities. Like the oppressive structures or roles are that these spaces or places might play. So, and this is definitely a form of that, literally, and envisioning and helping assist it. It's a blueprint. It's an architectural blueprint. It references architectural blueprint and the, you know, the pigments, also indigenous materials. And it also, and it references, you know, a form of escape and a way out through a system that has been built to, you know, poison and literally poison, I mean, through arsenic, and lock away and in a space that has all the means to care for humidity, et cetera, all these things. The thing it can't do most is spiritual care for our objects. And that breaks my heart. Always has, as an artist, to go into these places and see that and experience it as I travel the world. Like, so that's what this work is, and it's a way out, and it's a map out, and it's a way of just a clear way out. So
it's always broken my heart too, and many of us can feel it when we're in a building.
Yeah.
Happening, and usually in the basements or in the corners of the space. Yeah,
it is. And I travel the world studying my culture at home, but I can't access any of these things. I have to get them everywhere else. So I've been in all those spaces. I've been in those basements. I've been to those spots.
I'm going to scroll through the rest of the images as I'm going to let Julian come back on and ask his first question of you, and then I will stop sharing and answer questions from the crowd.
Thanks, Wanda. It's really interesting that you should settle on, you know, architecture of return / escape. You know, what I wanted to ask you at the beginning of this program, Nicholas, I enumerated multiple museum collections where your work is represented. And so I wanted to ask you, and it's also a question for you, Wanda, but maybe first for Nicholas, you know, what conditions are needed for works to be cared for culturally and spiritually in museums?
I feel like I can't answer that question for anybody. Like, it's such a broad conversation that is going to be needed to be held per object, per community, per, I feel like there's even the idea of decolonial and museum are like such contrasting words and ideas that the spaces are transformed significantly and continue to. And, you know, that a lot of that is probably largely because our communities are fighting to have representation in those spaces. Our communities are going directly into them and engaging with them in certain ways. And it's slow. It's so slow. But it varies now. I feel like it varies in community to community. Like we're moving and we're changing and shifting always. So I think being malleable and able to move is more important than like standing by your statements of existence and as an institution. I know that some of these spaces will do things like store and care for the object, not even on display, and then let it go out and live through ceremonies, through engagement with the community, and then be back again, like those things. Whether or not that's necessary, that's up to these communities, I suppose, but and how they want to. I always say, like, for a long time, there's been this myth that if there weren't museums, we wouldn't have things. But the irony is, what built those museums and what actions built those museums, and how did those things get placed into those spaces? Oftentimes it would say collected from a grave. Like, look at the use of language there. Like, I'm going to go back and collect it from a museum, and I probably get arrested in the process of doing that. So those use of those terms does not go both ways. Stolen from a grave is another thing. Like, yeah, we could say that, but it varies so much, I think. So I don't know if I mean,
Wanda, do you want to just chime in a little bit? I have maybe a follow-up question, but what's your perspective on that? Because, you know, there's you, the maker, Nicholas, the maker, the artist, and then you, Wanda, the curator, you know, the stem of that word being to care for, cura, to care for, at least in the sort of Western Latin language, right? So what? How do you do that? How do you navigate that part of it from your perspective?
I think, as Nick's pointing out, it's an intensely complex and multifaceted answer that's required. But I think the number one thing is to understand the history of where it came from. So how did it arrive? This is something museums, you know, we talk about provenance, but actually for Indigenous material, there's often very little information there, and definitely doesn't go deep into the notion of theft and grave robbing and all of that kind of stuff. Like, we have to take a hard look at ourselves and our collections, and I do take a hard line with return, especially for ceremonial and sacred belongings, because they don't belong to us. They belong to whoever imbued them with a spirit, and whoever will benefit from the healing from that spirit, or from the engagement with that spirit. That spirit wants to be with their kin, with their aunt, you know, they are the ancestor, you know, of. So I think it's really important that we become really comfortable with that. One of the issues that has been raised is that museums, communities are required to create museums in order to repatriate their belongings. And this is like a huge, you know, some places have done a really great job of being able to raise that capital, be able to do that, and then still be able to institute some Indigenous thinking and ways of being within those museums. But many, many don't want to go that route, right? They want to bring it back to the families who may have a relationship with those things, or they may want to put the totem pole back in the ground, which is what happened very recently, right? When a totem pole was repatriated to a community, they wanted it to go to rest, to feed the earth, and to continue that cycle of life and death that Indigenous people are totally comfortable with. The West's pretty afraid of death. This is one conversation we could have, that museums are just about staving our fear of death. And when it comes to historical Indigenous material. And then I think working with giving over control to communities so that they can decide, you know, if it needs to be feasted, if it needs to be smudged, if it needs all of those kinds of things. And we have to stop treating them with scientific eyes. So no more testing, no more adding arsenic into them, no more of that kind of, we would say murder, you know. So yeah, I think it's a very complex field, but we focus most of our collecting around contemporary artists like Nick, you know, in the last 3 years, 4 or 5 years that I've been here. And that is because I think artists are asking these questions. We want to deal with now. We want people to understand that Indigenous folks are still here. The cultures are changing, adapting. There's a lot going on, that a lot to offer the world, other than our misunderstood past.
Mm. Thank you. There's a question I'll just share with you both that came in from one of our viewers. It's really for you, Nicholas. And it is, as an artist capitalizing on wild animals such as wolves and deer, how do you recognize and acknowledge their lives, the lives that they've given up to allow you to create artwork?
As an artist capitalizing, I don't know if capitalizing is the word. living amongst and with in our community is definitely a deeper relationship to place and continuum. Understanding that and understanding the significance of it is beyond an exchange of monetary, like, here, I'm going to do this and make this. There's spiritual connection to that. There's spiritual connection to those are songs, there's stories, there's other histories that involve our communities directly to these things. And then on the other end, some of these things in the work, for instance, could even come from, depending on where it was sourced, like the We Dreamt Deaf, that piece, the polar bear was shot in Shishmaref in the 60s. And this is also part of the context of the work. The polar bear was shot by a white sport hunter. When white sport hunters were able to travel to Alaska to hunt for trophy, that's not legal here anymore, for polar bears at least. So that piece is speaking directly to those histories as well. And including that from Shishmaref, it's important conversation still and relevant and tied into this exchange of relationship to land and place, because Shishmaref is a community in Alaska that's currently experiencing climate crisis, immediately impacted by it, to where the village is going to have to be relocated. And that's based on other actions that of people from away from that space that don't see the impact directly felt by that community. So We Dreamt Deaf implicates that in a way of, you know, a deafness to our need and to humanity's like movement through the world at the cost of these spaces being the first to be impacted by it. So polar bears being one, and the polar communities, and then of course a village like Shishmaref. And to me, the process of male white sport hunter going to a community to shoot a trophy kind of demonstrates that mentality in a way that ties back into that work. So yes, I do work with these things, but I don't always directly work with them in ways that are significant culturally, in a sense, to my community. I've also engaged them in how other communities have, you know, consumed. So,
yeah, go ahead, Wanda, go ahead.
I think it's important to say that you wouldn't go out and kill a wolf to make an artwork. I think that's the difference.
Yeah, certainly, for sure. And I wouldn't go do that to make these works to have these conversations for that. So,
one of the things I sort of hear in your response there is the sort of really, and it's built into every work that you both sort of discussed this afternoon, is the rich layering of meaning and nuance. And I think especially of the piece that you made out, you know, in Aguascalientes, where as you sort of described the different contexts for that piece, I mean, it's so multidimensional, the sort of different narratives and histories and issues that it brings to the surface, that it's a very clear response to that particular question that was asked about sort of motivations, because it's multiple and complex.
Yeah, for sure. And there's, for me, I always think of connection as such an important aspect to this conversation. And I feel like disconnect can cause so much harm, and disconnect can cause so much like damage to place or space or community, any of these things. So yeah.
One question. Go ahead, Wanda. Go.
Speaking of connection, I think one thing that excites me also about your work is, I mean, you are doing it in many, many places, but whenever you go in to do work in a place, how is it that you build those connections? How is it that I'm connected enough that you see the layers of a site and a community's engagement with that site?
I think it varies. Obviously, it's not easy to gain immense access or connection in any community immediately, regardless. And I would never claim to have that understanding, I think. But I think we carry with us some shared experiences, and some of those things as Indigenous artists and makers, I've noticed become, you know, spaces to build on with each other. And I say this by experience through just traveling internationally and going out to communities, living in Aotearoa and working with the Maori community, or going out to Japan and meeting with the Ainu. There's definitely shared understandings and experiences that we can exchange. And I think those are great sources for this. But yeah, it's always difficult and it's always tricky to do that. And I don't ever claim to speak for communities when I go to their places to work. And I feel like doing so always, maybe it engages, well, has to from include my perspectives from what I'm familiar with, and that, you know, like Cook has traveled to Alaska and to our spaces. When we speak of land rights, I think that those land rights expand across all of, you know, internationally, even, like, you know, these are global conversations that our communities still face. So, yeah, I love the possibility of doing more of this and, you know, connecting with other communities and sharing in those ways. But
One question I wanted to ask you, Nicholas, I think I read somewhere you saying, you know, I work with concepts and the medium follows. I wanted to ask you, you know, is there a particular material that you're really excited about right now that you're working with? You've got such a diverse range of materials and practices. Is there something that you're really going with right now?
I mean, I have projects that I'm working on. I'm building a canoe right now, carving a canoe for Juno, which is it's a cultural project, and it's going to be a cultural use canoe, and I'm training an apprentice and then, you know, building curriculum around that. But that for me right now is really enjoyable work. It's challenging. It's, I always think of it as life work, in a sense where I feel like I've been training my life as a carver to do this type of work. And so there's a joy in that and challenge in that. Music, I've got some music right now, a record that's being released by Sub Pop Records in Seattle that is released end of the month. So that's exciting. Yeah, I don't know. There's not like a other than the projects that are here right now, it's kind of,
I think that gives us a sense that, you know, in whatever, less than an hour, we barely scratched the surface of the creative universe that you travel in. But I just wanted to thank you very much and Wanda for sharing this time with us and with our supporters and friends at the Art Gallery of Ontario. We really hope that everybody stays safe. It's a difficult time out there, a vulnerable time. So please take care of yourselves. And if you can, join us again next month on May the 11th at 5:30, because there'll be a conversation between a colleague at University of Toronto. Her name is Cara Krumpetich, and Adam Levine, our assistant curator, and they'll be talking about decolonizing museum practices. So a lot of threads probably between some aspects of today's conversation and what we'll do next month. So thank you very much for tuning in. Thank you, Nicholas. Thank you, Wanda. And take good care, everyone. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
See you.
Thanks, Wanda.
Nick.